something that was not serious. It was grounded in the idea of play, that we have hobbies, we have our interests, we have these things we love to do, which mean something to us, and are rewarding and satisfying. They're something that we have great control over, because they're ours. But the most important thing is we would most likely do them anyway, without reward, without recognition, without financial gain. And I began to see this, say, in the early 2000s, in, these are adults, not, I'm not talking about kids playing, adults, innovators, creative people that are around technology. When they saw some new technology came out, they wanted to take a wrap off and play with it, figure out what it was good for, and what they could do with it, and how they could change it. You know the term hacker, sometimes used in a negative context. But hacking is a way of modifying or changing something, and often making it do something it was not really intended to do. Makers are all of that. And out of that play, that immersion in a technology, comes innovation. And I think of this as bottom-up innovation, grassroots innovation. It's not the kind of innovation that comes from an R&D lab or a well-financed incubator. It comes out of this community of experimentation and play. Now, it's happened before, and you recognize the figures on there, but this is a quote of from Wozniak saying, I love going down to the homebrew computer club and showing off my ideas and my designs. And I would do that for free for the rest of my life. Now, things worked out a little bit better for me than just doing it for free, but I think you get the idea. And that's the first Apple computer. It's pretty crude. So when you look at maker things today, realize that they can be improved. And as some of us mentioned, they could really use some good design. So I started Make Magazine about in 2005. And it sort of grew out of this idea that people were hacking the physical world. They were not going to look at profiles. You can change the way things work. The physical world isn't necessarily set up for those kind of interfaces. But what if it was? What if physical things connected to digital things? I also went back and had the idea and found really a tradition to embrace, if you will. Just as you might look back in Italy and find those traditions. But in America, it was a magazine called Popular Mechanics. It still exists, but in the early 20th century, maybe these things start in the second decade of the 20th century for some reason. You know, it was a magazine that had fun things to do. It was all about fun. And this is 1961. You know, and guys on the right are current versions kind of doing the same thing that's on the cover. But look at the bottom of that. Make your own printed circuits. We were still doing these things today. A little bit different tools, but it was there. It was kind of pre-computer. In many ways, the computer killed off a lot of this because it became the tool we learned and focused on. And now I think we've sort of digested the computer and have looked for other things. This is 1944, What to Make, a special edition of Popular Mechanics 50 Cents. So we've updated that whole idea, put different kinds of people on the cover, but and different kinds of projects. You can see field remote objects with sonar, control machines with your eyes. These are things that not someone else is doing, this is something you can do. That's the promise today. Not that some genius in some research lab did it, but you can do it. This is a project from the current magazine. Anybody know what that is? What? What'd you say?
Geiger counter.
Geiger counter. So, remember the Japan earthquake? and the tsunami and the subsequent nuclear meltdown. People were hungry to find Geiger counters. They couldn't buy them. They also needed batteries if the lights were out. But what happened is we relied on our government to provide us with the radiation data from the fallout, and people in Japan said, the government's not giving us good information. I need to test that myself. And we need to share that data on the internet. And so this project comes out of that movement of people trying to figure out how to build their own Geiger counter and make it so that it was a data logging Geiger counter. So as many have mentioned today, open source hardware it is kind of at the core of what we're doing here. We're taking the ethos and almost the instrumentation of open source software and applying it to physical things. And many things come along with that. And one is the idea of a community collaborating, contributing, and growing a base of software. Now, you may not say, that may not register with you. Let me give you an example. If you have a term paper and you're a student, okay, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, you would have gone to the school library and done your research. Today, you go to Wikipedia. Pretty much copy that into your term paper, I guess. But imagine if Wikipedia isn't there. You have to go back to that library, you have to find that book may be missing. So this idea of sharing creates this foundation that you're able to build on top of. Ideally, you don't copy Wikipedia. You get some basic information that allows you to refine what you are doing and what you're building on top of that. In much the same way, the difference between Web 1.0 and Web 2.0 is that 2.0, they were platforms, stacks, software that developers could use, and they needed smaller teams and less money to do so. Which means they could get to market and prove their idea more efficiently. The other side that we're seeing here is like the guitar. We're all using the same tools, and Chris mentioned it today. But think about that. It used to be that there was professional-grade tools and then these amateur, consumer-grade tools. They're like collapsing on each other. And it's not always good for the professional tool makers. MakerBot is important, not because it invents 3D printing, but because it brings the price point down and that ordinary people can buy a 3D printer and put it in their house and do something with it. The funny thing, these enthusiasts, these makers, they don't know what they're going to do with the 3D printer, but they want one anyway. Just as the early personal computer hackers wanted a personal computer so they could figure out what it was good for. So fabrication, the fabrication tools, the techniques, the ideas here, to be able to make almost anything, to make one of most anything. These are breakthroughs. And again, you may not quite get that yet, but sometimes we see things on the 3D printers and they look, you know, they're just like people printing out figures. But the guy also was showing me a small jet engine that he had printed out on a 3D printer. And this is the work environment. This is actually Georgia Tech University, a mechanical engineering department. Just walking in, they have makerspace there. I'm glad to see a copy of my magazine, but it's an Eggbot. It's another little CNC type of machine. And they're, you know, designing on computers and, in a sense, going from there to making things. The other thing that I think is really important here that's made all of this kind of come together is the notion of interconnected communities. We all know that communities exist by geography, by skills, by interests. But what if they're all sort of interconnected in ways that were not possible? And it's even possible for you to move from community to community easily, to be that person who has a foot in the 3D printing community and a foot in Rome and a foot in, a marathon. And somehow you end up putting those things together in unique ways and coming up with new ideas. So two things that I want to kind of emphasize is where I think the maker movement comes together. Something that followed on about a year after the magazine's Maker Fair, and then, as we mentioned here several times, makerspaces, the physical getting together. When you're doing software, open source software online, you can collaborate pretty easily by just sharing your code on GitHub and finding discussion groups. But there seems to be something about doing physical things, making physical goods, that you want to be physically together to share ideas and expertise. Part of that is because a lot of the way you still learn in this community is looking over someone's shoulder, just watching it happen, on a one-on-one basis. So this is Maker Faire. And I could show you some great videos about Maker Faire. We could have a lot of fun with it because it's spectacular fun. I mean, last year in the Bay Area, we had over 100,000 people on 2 days. And it's just packed with families, people showing very interesting things. And back to the idea of community. What it really is an opportunity to flush out of the community all these things that are in someone's basement, backyard, garage. That's their private project. And they are here to show it and showcase it to other people. So Maker Faire is a bit of an art fair, a craft fair, a science fair, kind of mashed together. And you'll see all kinds of things, but it's motivated really by the chance to see how many people are standing around the 3D printer on break. I mean, they just want to stand and watch it go. And they want to ask the people who built it, how does it work? What does it do? Why is it set up that way? It's that kind of conversation that Maker Faire enables. And I think the real exciting thing is there's talk here about doing Maker Faire, whether somewhere, maybe multiple places in Italy. So let me just speak to that for a moment. Maker Faire is a little bit like what you see in the corridor out there where people have brought their projects and ideas. But what if each of you brought something? Instead of sitting here, we'd have your project and you'd be talking about it. You'd have a big smile on your face because you're very proud of it and you want to let people know what you love doing. And the task of building a Maker Faire and creating a Maker Faire is really one of community building. It's going out into the community, finding where the robots are, finding where the interactive art is, finding the embroidery folks, and again, trying to push them together, mash them together into that event. And what it does is it allows those communities to interconnect, and they become resources to each other. So here's some of the fun things. I mean, this is the head of a robotic giraffe. It's 19 foot tall. These are electric muffins that speed around the fair. So a lot of this is sort of entertainment. It's fun. And people build these, almost on the idea of, creating a behavior that interacts with other people. I mean, people love to gather around these muffins. They even have Acme Muffineering Garage where they fix them when they're broken. So we've seen Maker Faire grow. The blue lines are the ones we've organized, and the red lines are the growth of independent or mini Maker Faires that we've opened it up and said, here's what we know about making a Maker Faire. If you want to create one of your own, you can go ahead and do so. This is where Maker Faires will be taking place this year. There's about 50 of them, and spread out around the globe. So, just as they get together a Maker Faire, it brings people together for a weekend, and tremendous energy, tremendous sense that, look at what we have in our community. I want to emphasize, Maker Faire is not about bringing something from California to, say, a place like Rome. It is a matter of finding in Rome and in Italy where your makers are. Who are the people here that do cool cool things. They're here. You just don't know where they are yet. They really are. I mean, I'm always amazed. Obviously, you have someone like Massimo Bonzi that's a leader and is pretty well connected to a group of them. But I think he would admit, if you had a fair, he'd find, you know, two-thirds of the people would be new. The other places where makers get together is called makerspaces, also called hackerspaces, also called fab labs. So it seems to be important to combine skills, tools, resources, expertise in a place. And some of these places are quite small. The resources are small as well, in dollars. But the energy and the heart that's there is quite large. This is a place in Dallas, Texas, kind of a collage of photos. Some of the things that happen in makerspaces, they build their own furniture. The table, work tables there were built by the members. They're organized by function. They have a craft room. They have a bio lab. They have a wood shop. They have an auto shop working on an electric car there. Someone bought an old CNC machine and is creating a new software interface for it. So it reflects that sort of DIY spirit. And the right are hammers from the blacksmith area. So we see makerspaces that are freestanding in a building on their own. They're in science centers, in libraries, churches, and museums. Particularly interested in new museums and science centers where it's a new kind of interaction to invite people, say, going into an art museum to make art, instead of just seeing art, to participate. The one place we don't see enough of them in is education. And that's my personal goal, is to figure out how to get makerspaces in schools. Replacing some of the old shop class that we had in Western America. Replacing even the computer lab, which isn't well used today in most places. And to encourage kids to create, participate, make things based on their own interests, not based on an academic agenda. At the core of this maker movement is the notion of projects. This is what, it's the unit of work. It's what we do and what we share. And getting people to share, that has made all the difference. Even in the makerspace, I visit one, some makers will write the name of their project, the URL, and an email. It says, here's what I'm doing, so you can contact me. But at the heart of this, particularly in education, it's not just about what you know, it's what you can do with what you know. And makers are particularly good at that. And they figure out that they don't know something, and they rely on the community, they rely on online resources, or they rely on their friends to find out. So just, here's an example of how this all fits together. I saw this as an exhibit at our Maker Faire in Detroit last summer. And it was a group of about five 20-year-olds who, some were in school, some weren't. And it's an autonomous balloon. And this is pretty much the telemetry section of it. But they were trying to build a balloon to do a transatlantic crossing. And this was their test rig for that. When I asked them where they were from, they said Louisville, Kentucky, and they said they were from the hackerspace there. This is their project, the White Star Balloon Project. Now, about 3 years ago, two teachers came to the Maker Faire in the Bay Area from Louisville and met other people who had makerspaces. And they went home and said, we need a makerspace there. And they started one. And they came back last year to meet other people and be part of the groups that exhibit from makerspaces. But what had happened is, and these weren't the founders, but that makerspace gave life to this project, this White Star Balloon Project, because someone walked in and said, I'm interested in doing, you know, high altitude ballooning, and I need some other people who know things that want to work on the project. So that project was formed, incubated, and shared there. I don't know what will happen to it, whether it will ever be commercialized. It might just be a fun project. Here's another example. It was in our magazine of a couple guys, instead of being at a hackerspace, these guys were at NASA, the space agency in America, but they were figuring out they could build satellites for under $8,000. NASA was spending millions of dollars on this. Right? It just recently spun out an asset instead of a company. So one of the trends here is that makers use off-the-shelf components to create things that many large companies spent a lot of time creating proprietary closed versions of. Kits are a really important thing here. We just did a special issue on kits. It is a way to organize projects for a lot of people. I like this quote from Michael Stray, an economist who wrote it, talented amateurs don't just build kits. Kids build talented amateurs. It's a business model. They're like apps. It gives makers something they can sell. It's a way to get started for new makers. And it also gives them access to components that they might find some difficulty to buy individually. So in summary, you know, the maker movement is open hardware meets open software. You throw in a little bit of fabrication tools. You make kits available to a broad number of people. And you have this highly connected community of makers. And out of that, I think, comes a new culture of creativity. Now, the real thing I think that matters is whether this culture of creativity is limited to the few people that raise their hands here. Meaning, an insignificant number of people raise their hands. If this movement is to be something like a renaissance, it has to be motivated by something like this. All of us are makers. All of us can participate. All of us are leaders and followers.